welcome, welcome, welcome. And it's time for the Legal Lounge here on CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com, streaming live coast to coast and around the world on CRNTalk.com. Also available in stunning high definition video on Facebook.com/CRNTalk. Also, Tiki Live, CRN's custom-built Roku channel, available in the Roku store for free, of course, and of course on CRNTalk.com. I'm joined, as always, by the one and the only. He's an active attorney, a U.S. Army veteran, Juris Doctorate in Law, undergraduate degree in physics, and author of a book that has proven to be a guideline for the Supreme Court now and in the future. That book, American Illusion of Freedom, is available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Richard Nixon. Sir, how are you?
I thank you for that very gracious introduction, Mike. today, I think what we're going to talk about is the so-called contentious docket. That is that the new justices are awaiting start of the Supreme Court's false term. And very briefly, we're going to be talking about one of the blockbuster cases is out of North Carolina that would remove state courts from any role in election-related laws passed by the legislatures, the so-called independent state legislature theory, which argues that the state legislatures have total authority over federal elections. We're also going to be talking about two schools, if you will, a private school, Harvard, and a public school, University of North Carolina, in terms of whether or not they can consider race when it comes to admissions, the main theory being that there's too many smart Asians, if you will, that want to go to Harvard, and Harvard's trying to figure out how to balance diversity with merit. They want to be fair to everyone, and yet there's, frankly, too many Asians for Harvard to take. Anyway, that's my take. The other thing we're going to be talking about here is the wetlands case, which talks about an attempt by an Idaho couple, Michael and Chantel Sackett, to build a house on a piece of property that's been determined by the EPA to be a water of the United States and therefore a violation of the Clean Water Act, and they've been prevented from building their home.
Also, we have the Supreme Court term is starting this fall. We finally have a full photograph of the most current iteration of the justices, including newly sworn in Justice Jackson Brown. And we're going to talk about, of course, the cases that Richard mentioned, Sackett versus EPA. We're going to talk about Merrill versus Milligan, Moore versus Harper, Students for Fair Admissions Incorporated versus Presidents and Fellows of Harvard College. Also, we're going to be talking about, for you bacon lovers out there, National Pork Producers versus Ross. So a lot of interesting cases on the docket for this coming Supreme Court term. And we, of course, have a 6-3 conservative majority. Some say the most constructionalist court we've seen in at least my lifetime. So very interesting to see. And you mentioned Harvard. We should also mention the university, State University of Northridge, which I attended.
Oh, yes, that's right.
Which is known as the Harvard of the Valley. So
I see.
There you go. We'll stick around, you guys. We'll be right back. We're going to be talking about some cases having to do with election law and, as Richard mentioned, the independent state legislature doctrines. Stick around. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Are you paying too much for term life insurance? There's a tremendous price war among the major term life companies. Rates have dropped dramatically in the past 2 years. For example, a man age 45 non-tobacco user, $1 million of coverage is only $75 per month, level for the next 10 years. Or a man age 50 non-tobacco user can buy $500,000 of coverage for a monthly premium of only $110, guaranteed not to change for the next 20 years. That's right, level rates for 20 years. And if you're a smoker, we have great rates for you as well. At the Term Lifeline, we specialize in policies of $500,000 and above. So if you're looking for new or replacement term life insurance, call right now for a free quote.
Rates and availability may vary by state. Sample rate quotes are based on preferred non-tobacco underwriting exam required to qualify.
800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. That's 800-349-6855.
Five. And we are back in the Legal Lounge, Sierra Digital Talk Radio. Thank you so much for joining us, Richard Nixon Live. Talking about some important cases, some historic cases that we're going to be seeing adjudicated in the upcoming fall term, 2022, for the Supreme Court. And two cases that are on the docket. These have to do with state sovereignty when it comes to elections and the separation of powers between the judicial branch and the legislative branch.
Yes.
In states when it has to do with election procedures. We're speaking about Moore versus Harper, which is a case out of North Carolina, and Merrill versus Milligan out of Alabama. Both these cases have to do with maps drawn post-2020 census, where certain states have added representatives and congressional maps need to be withdrawn to allow for that additional seat. Moore versus Harper is the first case we're going to talk about. It's a pending Supreme Court of case, of course, and it's related to the, as aforementioned, independent state legislature theory. I don't necessarily think the independent state legislature is a theory. I think it's more of a doctrine, personally.
Well, it is, and it's actually in the U.S. Constitution. If I might, what they're talking about there is that the Founding Fathers were prescient enough, as we talked about in our show prep today, to remember or to remind everyone that the state legislatures are supposed to be the main authority in this country under the Constitution. And Article 1, Section 4, Clause 1 says, "The times, places, and manner of holding elections for senators and representatives shall be prescribed in each state by the legislatures thereof." And further, that Congress can at any time make changes to this, except for choosing the places of senators. Now, that has to do with senators and representatives. And Article 2 says very briefly, "Each state shall appoint in such manner as the legislature of the state may direct a number of electors equal to the whole number of senators," and so on, may be entitled. Now, the point I'm getting at is that the founders were prescient enough to include within a federal statute, a federal constitution, the ultimate authority on who becomes a senator or a representative or a president in the federal constitution, if you will. And this is what it's all about, the arguments under the two cases that we're going to be discussing, Moore versus Harper and the other one. Basically, the issue is, to what extent does the legislature have absolutely exclusive authority to dictate how the issues will be run based upon the Constitution, or should the state courts have something to say if they feel that the legislature of that particular state has done something wrong? And so that's the issue.
It's the issue indeed, is because these cases, Moore versus Harper and Merrill versus Milligan, both have to do with redistricting and the interference, the lawsuits that certain actors have made against these congressional maps. And according to the independent state legislature doctrine outlined, like you said, Richard, in Article 1, Section 4, is that the state legislatures are in charge of anything to do with elections.
Yes.
The statute reads, "The times, places, and manner," times, places, and manner pretty much encompass everything to do with election procedures, "of holding elections for senators and representatives shall be prescribed in each state by the legislature thereof, but the Congress may at any time by law make or such alter such regulations, except as to the places of choosing senators." And so the question here before the Supreme Court, is that whether or not the courts have any place in adjudicating disputes between parties suing over these redrawn congressional district maps.
Yes, the courts or the governor or the president, for that matter, when the U.S. Constitution makes it very clear for those of us who are originalists that it's only the legislature that makes that determination.
And we saw this play out too in 2020 to great effect, when we saw, especially in Pennsylvania, where we saw the Supreme Court of the state of Pennsylvania pretty much contradict the legislature of Pennsylvania,
right,
when it came to due of the times, places, and manners of holding the 2020 presidential
Correct.
Election, because the state Supreme Court found that because of COVID, that some of these protocols must be changed to accommodate COVID, specifically mail-in voting.
Correct. And this is where Trump and his attorneys had a point, I believe, in they looked at the Constitution as written, and as Attorney Eastman has said many times, the Constitution is not suspended when you have an emergency. There's nothing in there that suggests that. And therefore, these amendments that were made by the Pennsylvania Supreme Court in violation of the legislature and therefore in violation of the U.S. Constitution were void. And therefore, Mr. Trump's argument that the his election that he lost was frankly rigged.
And Mr. Alito, Justice Alito, regarding this Pennsylvania case, which we've talked about before, the name of the case is Republican Party of Pennsylvania versus Secretary of State of Pennsylvania. And I'll read from some of Mr. Alito's dissent. I agree with Justice Thomas that we should grant review in these cases. They present an important and recurring constitutional question. Whether the Elections or Electors Clause of the United States Constitution, Article 1, Section 4, Clause 1, or Article 2, Section 1, Clause 2, are violated when a state court holds that a state constitutional provision overrides a state statute governing the manner in which federal elections is to be conducted. And I think the answer to that question is yes.
Yes. Do we have time for me to read these two different issues?
Right after the break. We got about 2 minutes before the break,
okay.
And I want to give you plenty of time for that because we're going to give you kind of both sides of the coin here.
Correct.
On that, there's particular, one side the right, one side the left are supportive of both different issues here.
Right.
But these cases in question, Moore versus Harper and Merrill versus Milligan, they do have to do with redistricting along racial lines. And one thing that Justice Jackson Brown said specifically in this Merrill versus Milligan case, she took an original List position, according to
her. Yes, she did.
She says that the 14th Amendment and the 15th Amendment, where the Voting Rights Act was extrapolated from 1965, says that that was a race-conscious goal of the drafters of those amendments, the 14th. The drafters, she observed, were trying to ensure that people who have been discriminated against were actually brought equal to everybody else in society. This is not a race-neutral or race-blind idea. Is that an originalist statement,
Richard? Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because we talked about before, the 14th Amendment was specifically drafted to address the needs of former slaves.
Exactly. To make them equal to the free person, the non-slaves.
What I think that Ms. Jackson has a little bit wrong is she's doing the same thing that the others have done with the 14th Amendment is she's extrapolating that to cover the Voting Rights Act, which was
Correct.
An act of Congress. But we're going to stick around, you guys, right back. We're going to talk about the two separate sides of the coin here when it comes to these particular cases, Moore versus Harper, and of course, Merrill versus Milligan. So stick around. We're in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Richard's fantastic book, American Illusion of Freedom. It's available where fine books are sold, including Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Stick around, you guys. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's vine-to-bar chocolate. Order some today at vinetobar.com. That's vinetobar.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
When you really want Italian food, you have got to get to Columbo's. Columbo's Italian Steakhouse and Jazz Club. Colorado Boulevard, Eagle Rock. It's that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Today, it seems so hard to enjoy just a little bit of easy. So much of life seems to get in the way. But fear not. Seekers of fabulous food and fun and thrill, Columbo's is Southern California's answer to Easy Street. Great grub with some of the finest steaks, the freshest fish awaiting for you to devour. Did I mention Columbo's family Italian recipes? Columbo's spaghetti bolognese, their chicken pesto ravioli, Magnifico, and of course, the world's greatest meatballs. I can go on. But why go on when you can go on over to Columbo's and experience delicious and easy for yourself? Columbo's, of course, that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Columbo's, mind you, Ben.
Let's talk about your credit cards. When you first start using them, it's a slow drip. You make charges, then more charges, then bills come, and they keep coming. When you open your statements, the floodgates come pouring in. You realize you have more credit card debt than you can afford, and you're barely making the minimum payments. Wouldn't it be nice to make one affordable payment and have all your credit card bills covered? Make this free call and learn our responsible way to get your credit card bills paid and under control.
Sponsored by Consumer Education Services, a nonprofit organization.
800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. That's 800-876-3643.
CESI is not a loan company. The establishment of a debt management plan may adversely affect your credit rating. Non-payment of debt may lead creditors to increase finance and other charges to undertake collection activity, including liquidation.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. Thank you so much once again for joining us. All previous sessions available on YouTube. Also available as a podcast at crntalk.com/podcaster. Take us with you on the go. So, Richard, we're talking about these two cases. They have to do with this independent state legislature doctrine, which briefly is that the state legislature is pretty much constitutionally or in charge of anything that has to do with elections.
Right.
That's what the framers wanted, and that's what the framers got. And that has been solidified in Article 1, Section 4, and Article 2, Section 1. So there's been two kind of reactions, both from left and from right, and they both kind of support two different theories regarding these cases. What are those, Richard?
Well, interestingly enough, if you check it out on the Internet, which I did for our show prep today, you'll see that under the SCOTUS blog, the issue is whether a state's judicial branch may nullify the regulations governing the manner of holding elections for senators and representatives prescribed by the legislature thereof and replace them with regulations of the state court's own devising based on vague state constitutional provisions purportedly vesting the state judiciary with power to prescribe whatever rules it deems appropriate to ensure a fair or free election, in quotes. So you can see that that's kind of slanted toward leaving it for the legislature as opposed to the state's judiciary. And then you have the other side that is pro-state, if you will, pro-judiciary, if you will. And they say in Moore versus Harper, the Supreme Court will decide whether the North Carolina Supreme Court has the power to strike down the legislature's illegally gerrymandered congressional map for violating the North California Constitution. The legislators have argued that a debunked interpretation of the U.S. Constitution, known as the independent state legislature theory, renders the state courts and state constitutions powerless in matters relating to federal elections. Now, this is common amongst attorneys. They try to define the issue as fast as they can that favors their own client. And hopefully, if you can define the issue, you've got to step forward in getting the judge to rule in your favor.
Well, and also they use language that might not necessarily be tied to the facts.
Like exactly.
When they say illegally drawn districts, right. I haven't seen any sort of criminal adjudication regarding that.
And you can hear Perry Mason saying, objection, facts not in evidence.
Facts
it's
not
exactly
held in evidence.
Right.
And so you have one side, I'll just say the left,
yes,
who are more about siding with the courts on this side.
Correct.
Because they believe that the courts should be able to go in there and adjudicate anything that they think is unfair.
Right.
Especially because the way that these districts are drawn would favor Republicans
right.
electorally.
Right.
Then you have others on the right who support more of the independent state legislature doctrine, because I think most people, I would say generally, and you know, I'm sorry if I'm wrong out there, but most generally are more pro-states' rights.
Correct.
And when what's interesting to me is when you see Democrats want to support the ability for courts to come in, and even the Supreme Court, nine unelected justices sitting high on robes, to come in there and pretty dictate election policy. That's kind of antithetical to the word democracy, wouldn't you say?
That's exactly right. And again, to me, it seems simple. Are we going to follow the Constitution or not? Now, it's interesting that I happened to watch the Mark Levin show this past weekend, and one of the issues he kept thumping on was the kind of the beginning of ignoring and disliking and disfavoring the Constitution by the Wilson administration and Mr. Wilson, President Wilson, personally. He hated it, and he's done everything. This country's done many, many things that it could to do whatever it can to ignore or destroy or defile. And this is what caused me to write my book, that so many of the decisions by the Supreme Court have been absolutely contrary to what we know from history, the founders intended. And it's interesting because I'm enlightened now, if you will, or encouraged, I should say, by this recent Supreme Court that seems to be aiming at correcting some of those errors from the past.
Yeah, because, you know, absolute power corrupts absolutely. And you saw, you know, especially during, you know, the Warren Court, when the court, I think, kind of became drunk on its own power.
Absolutely.
And it's kind of refreshing to see a court who could assert its own power.
Sure.
But chooses not to, based on the fact that the founders' intent was that it should be deferent to the people, which is the legislative
branch. Well, that's an excellent observation, Mike. That's the whole point. It's a stroke of generosity, if you will, for a judge, or in this case, the Supreme Court, to say, we could assert authority on this case, but if we're going to be true to our words and to the Constitution that we swore to uphold, we have to give this power back to the people. And that's exactly what they did in the Dobbs case. And that's exactly what they don't do in some of these authoritative governments.
Absolutely. Very well said, Richard. Stick around. We'll be right back.
No more mold. No more damage. No more outdated old bathroom. No more slipping and hurting. No more stress. Make your ordinary bathroom extraordinary for only $99 per month. New shower, new door, new tub, new wall, new anti-slip technology. Be stress-free. Call 800-973-5411. BCI Bath and Shower is made in America for the highest quality. Ask about our military and senior discounts. Your dream bathroom in as little as one day. First 50 callers save $1,500 on a never-clear glass-treated door. Call now for free premium color upgrades. 800-973-5411. Call BCI Bath and Shower, the leader in bathroom remodeling. Be smart, safe, and stay a step ahead of inflation with our interest-free financing options. Call 800-973-5411. Love your bathroom with free upgrades. Call 800-973-5411. 800-973-5411.
Hi, this is Fred Dwyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Do you want to fly somewhere, anywhere in the world? Smart travelers call myflightsearch.com for the best deals on flight tickets. going to Manila, Bangkok, London. How about Singapore? Call MyFlightSearch.com for the lowest flight tickets available. What about a local vacation? Let's say you want to fly to Vegas, Orlando, Miami, Los Angeles, or Denver. Pick up the phone and call MyFlightSearch.com right now. We have exclusive deals that you can't find anywhere else. The only way you can get these low airline prices is by calling us. We have so many low prices available, we can't possibly tell them to you right here and now. If you're flying somewhere anytime in the next 6 months and you want the lowest airline ticket prices anywhere, you owe it to yourself to save a ton of money. So pick up your cell phone and call MyFlightSearch.com right now.
Call 800-445-3166. 800-445-3166. That's 800-445-3166. Call now. 800-445-3166.
Enjoy Tiki Live, the best cable alternative choice today, with hundreds of premium live TV programming, including ESPN, CNN, Fox News, Disney, AMC, Bravo, XF, OWN, and CRN Talk. Plus, no contracts and low month-to-month service. Tiki Live, servicing North America, including the Caribbean. To get started, visit TikiLive.com to order hundreds of channels, including CRN Talk, at a fraction of what you're paying today. Visit TikiLive.com. That's TikiLive.com.
We're celebrating Wild Outdoors Women this week on The Revolution with Jim and Trav, with the toughest ladies in the outdoors. First, joining the broadcast is Stacey Lynn Harris, the all-new host of The Sporting Chef. Then Melissa Bachman from Winchester Deadly Passion. And finally, our very own Mrs. Bunny. The Revolution is presented by Outdoor Channel, Sportsman Channel, World Fishing Network, and My Outdoor TV. Saturday mornings at 7 o'clock Pacific Time on CRN Digital Talk, CRN2.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. As always, I'm joined by Richard Nixon. And if anybody, Richard's a veteran. Richard, thank you for your service.
Yes, sir. Welcome.
And if any of you out there served with Richard during his time of service in the United States Army or his time as a contractor in the Republic of South Vietnam, shoot us an email here at the CRN Digital Talk Broadcast Center at info@crntalk.com. That's info@crntalk.com. We want to give you a copy of Richard's fantastic book, and if maybe he'll sign it for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
So this next one is interesting. So there was a movie that came out a long time ago when I was a little kid. It was called Ghostbusters. It was a good,
yes,
good movie. And one of the main villains of the movie, aside from the ghosts, was the EPA, the Environmental Protection,
yes,
Agency. And I thought, how could, you know, the EPA be a villain? I mean, they're all about clean water, clean air. But it turns out they can take your property away, or at least inhibit you in enough litigation to make you go broke. And so this next case, Sackett versus the EPA, this is Sackett versus the Environmental Protection Agency 2023, because there was another Sackett versus EPA in 2012, same parties involved. And this has to do with the Commerce Clause.
Well, that reminds me of something that President Reagan said. He said it kind of half in jest, but it has some merit, and that is, you'd never want to hear someone say, I'm from the government and I'm here to help, because they ain't going to help you.
More hinder. So this is briefly the facts of the case. Chantella Michael Sackett purchased about a little over half of an acre of a vacant lot near Priest Lake, Idaho. This is in rural Idaho, in 2004. They began construction of their home in the spring of 2007 after attaining building permits from local authorities. Shortly after, officials from the United States Environmental Protection Agency informed the Sacketts that their lot might be subject to regulation under the Clean Water Act, as it contained, quote, wetlands, end quote, that were, quote, navigable waters, end quote. The EPA directed the Sacketts to halt construction until they received a permit from the United States Army Corps of Engineers.
Yes.
The Sacketts sued, and now we're seeing this go all the way to the Supreme Court.
Yes. And I think it's going to be clear that, again, this particular Supreme Court, I hope they last for another 30 or 40 years, frankly, we'll start interpreting the Constitution as written. There's really no basis for this extension, especially where this water exists intrastate, to talk about any kind of federal authority over that water. Now, again, the way they phrase it is that the wetlands case has been in the courts for years, starting with this couple called Sacketts to build a home on their property. They've been blocked by the EPA, which has determined that the area's wetlands and water of the United States under the Clean Water Act. The Supreme Court recently cut back on the EPA, and I think they might continue on that track. The Pacific Legal Foundation says that the EPA doesn't have jurisdiction over the land because it is not a traditional navigable water or an intrastate navigable water, and thus is not part of the so-called United States, and therefore it doesn't really connect. The whole point of this navigable water idea is that if we have water going from one state to another, and it's considered navigable, that is to say, we need ships to go from one state to another through that water. That's one thing that the federal government should control. But in many of these things, the water is strictly intrastate. There's no way in hell, other than a helicopter, that the boat could get from one lake to another in two different states.
Yeah, picture a mangrove plantation in Florida. Sure. Pretty much, this is like the tundra version of swampland. It's the only pretty much way you could navigate these waters is with galoshes or an airboat. And these poor Sacklers, what really galls me about this is they went through all the appropriate permitting processes at the state level, and you have a federal agency come in here and shut them down. And there's been similar cases involving this as well. Most recently, there was a case adjudicated, I believe, in 2006. It's the Rapinos case, R-A-P-N-O-S, and Chief Justice in that case, in that decision, warned that each landowner must be subject to a test. This is known as a made-up test by Associate Justice Anthony Kennedy called the Significant Nexus Test.
Yes.
And this is something they made up out of whole cloth, and the Significant Nexus Test means that if the wetlands are as waters of the United States, if there's a significant nexus between waters and the wetlands.
Yeah.
That wetlands are water, but they're not navigable.
Yeah.
And so what Chief Justice Roberts says is that each landowner must be subject to the test, and they must, quote, feel their way on a case-by-case basis, never knowing the potential outcome until significant time and money have been spent to seek clarity.
Well, Justice Kennedy has a history of imagining things, making things up, as you said. Many people adored him, loved him, because he had a fruitful mind, but he didn't realize that he was bound by the terms of the Constitution, or he came from the Wilsonian school that ignored the Constitution. In either event, he was wrong on many bases, and I think this current Supreme Court is going to correct these.
Scalia, also in the Rapinos case, said that the significant nexus test, even on paper, amounts to, quote, flouting of statutory command, end quote. And Justice Scalia foresaw that because the, quote, significant nexus test is perfectly opaque, it's not likely to constrain an agency whose disregard for the statutory language has been so long manifested.
Yes. And one of the things that the courts have said over and over and not followed is, especially when it comes to police conduct and so on, government conduct, is we don't want to give authorities authority that's too vague, because then they don't know what they can do and what they can't. And that's exactly what the EPA has done. It's taken over itself, created regulations for itself, and now they're kind of like run away.
Yeah, we've talked a lot about the administrative state, which
correct.
I kind of personally believe is like the real deep state, because these bureaucrats, lifelong bureaucrats, pretty much perpetuate that regulatory authority to justify their own careers.
Correct.
Rather than actually do the public service, do a public good. Okay, folks, we're going to talk about one more case right after the break. We're going to talk about the Port Council versus Ross. And this one is very interesting indeed, because it has to do with the recent ballot initiative passed here in the great state of California. Stick around, you guys. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Let's talk about your credit cards. When you first start using them, It's a slow drip. You make charges, then more charges, then bills come, and they keep coming. When you open your statements, the floodgates come pouring in. You realize you have more credit card debt than you can afford, and you're barely making the minimum payments. Wouldn't it be nice to make one affordable payment and have all your credit card bills covered? Make this free call and learn our responsible way to get your credit card bills paid and under control.
Sponsored by Consumer Education Services, a nonprofit organization.
800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. That's 800-876-3643.
CESI is not a loan company. The establishment of a debt management plan may adversely affect your credit rating. Non-payment of debt may lead creditors to increase finance and other charges to undertake collection activity, including liquidation.
What are you going to do with your old car? You can try selling it, you could junk it, or you could donate it to Heritage for the Blind. Your car will be towed away for free, and your donation is tax deductible. Just call 1-800-785-9618. Heritage for the Blind accepts cars, vans, trucks, and boats. It doesn't matter if your vehicle runs or not. It will be towed away for free, and you'll be supporting those that need help. Heritage for the Blind is a nonprofit organization that helps the visually impaired live fuller lives. Call right now to donate your car, and as a special thank you for calling, you'll receive a free 3-day vacation voucher to many exciting locations. Call Heritage for the Blind right now, 1-800-785-9618. Donating is easy, and your vehicle is towed away for free. Plus, you'll get a free vacation voucher. Call now, 1-800-785-9618. That's 1-800-785-9618.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, Sierra Digital Talk Radio, America, an Illusion of Freedom. Fantastic book, available wherever fine books are sold, including Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. You can also follow Richard on Twitter, Richard, at Richard A. Nixon 1, and on Parler as well, at PRES37TH. You can email him, and all that information is on the screen if you're watching this on Facebook or on YouTube. So this next case we're talking about, today we spent time talking about some cases that are going to appear on the fall docket of the Supreme Court's 2022 term. And this next one is National Pork Producers Council versus Ross. And this came out of Proposition 12 out of California, which was kind of known as an ethical way to treat pork, pigs, hogs raised here in California.
Right.
And this one is interesting because it was an initiative passed by the voters here in California, but now the National Pork Producers are suing because it might violate the Dormant Commerce Clause.
Yes.
What is the Dormant Commerce Clause?
Well, the Dormant Commerce Clause is that, first of all, the Commerce Clause is in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 3 of the U.S. Constitution, and it basically says that Congress has the power to regulate commerce with foreign nations and among the several states and with the Indian tribes. And its purpose was, according to James Madison, the father of our Constitution, was never really intended to micromanage the states in their interactions with each other, but to resolve disputes, that is to act as an arbitrator if the states had disagreements, if you will. And the Dormant Commerce Clause basically says that, now this is a doctrine that the Supreme Court invented. It's not in the Constitution. This doctrine prohibits a state from discriminating against or unduly burdening interstate commerce. So in other words, if something is traveling through interstate from one state to another, the states are prohibited from interfering therewith. And that's what they call the Dormant Commerce Clause. That is to say, it doesn't deal with the federal government. It deals with the states.
And many attorneys and also many judges, many jurists, I should say, have tried to use the Commerce Clause to extrapolate meaning from that for a long time.
Absolutely.
They try to use the Commerce Clause to justify overturning Dobbs, all sorts of other stuff. But this is really a cut and dry kind of case when it comes to the Commerce Clause, because let's say you raise California imports and exports pork products.
Yes.
And if you put an undue burden on out-of-state pork producers
right.
by saying that they have to ethically care for the hogs that will go to slaughter eventually, but you know right. you have to ethically treat them, that puts an undue burden and expense on those out-of-state producers, correct?
Correct.
And so the court here, I mean, this seems like a pretty cut and dry, because the Dormant Commerce Clause is supposed to kind of protect protectionism from state to state. Great line here. It's according to the Supreme Court, this prohibition on interfering with interstate commerce was rooted in the framers' concern that economic balkanization had the potential to doom the new union between states.
Yes.
And you know, post Articles of Confederation, pre-signing ratification of the Constitution, you saw a lot of states kind of fight economically with
Correct.
Trade tariffs, you know, back and forth.
Correct.
And so what do you think that who's going to prevail here, the National Pork Producers Council or the state of California?
Well, I believe that they're going to cite with the state of California, because I think they're going to do anything they can to reverse so many of these bad, bad decisions that extended the Commerce Clause way beyond what the founders intended. As I said, James Madison's version and definition of the Commerce Clause was strictly to resolve disputes. If, for instance, California and Arizona had a dispute between the transfer of hogs from one place to another, this would be a place for Article 1, Section 8, Clause 3, the Commerce Clause, for the federal government to get in, arbitrate, and resolve it. There's no argument here. It's strictly one state that is, I understand it's California, is it not? Simply wanting to have their own rules regarding how hogs or pigs are treated, and I think they should certainly have the authority to do that, and I think the court will agree.
Interesting. Okay, let's move on to this next case, the last one on the docket here for today. This one is Students for Fair Admissions versus President and Fellows of Harvard College. This case has been enjoined as well. The plaintiff, the student for fair admissions, is also suing the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill for a similar issue. This case involves the private school Harvard University's undergraduate admissions process. The reason that this is subject to review, judicial review, is because Harvard, even though it's a private college, it also is a very large research university and so receives federal grants, making it subject to Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which outlaws racial discrimination. We're going to break real fast, but I'm going to pose this question to you, Richard. Since the Supreme Court's ruling in Regents of University of California versus BACK, B-A-K-K-E, that's in 1978, racial quotas
right.
have been banned in university admissions. Put that in one hand.
Right.
On the other hand, a whole person review process that considers many qualities about each candidate, including race, in its admissions process, however, is legal under Supreme Court's rulings of both Grutter versus Bollinger, Fisher versus UT, and also Fisher versus UT Part 2.
Yeah.
So aren't those two things in question,
yes.
in tension between another, where you have, no, you can't have any sort of racial quota system as in University of California versus BACK, but you can use race
yes.
in admissions in those other two cases I mentioned. We're going to talk about that, discuss that right after the break. So stick around, you guys. We're in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Stay with us.
Have Medicare and do you use a CPAP machine? This is a national healthcare alert regarding your CPAP supplies. Using a clean CPAP mask and clean supplies is important to staying healthy. The best way to make sure your CPAP equipment is clean is to get new supplies. If you have Medicare, we have great news. Medicare will pay for you to have new clean supplies every 90 days. We'll even do all the paperwork for you to make sure that there's little to no out-of-pocket cost to you. And you don't even have to leave your home. We provide free in-home delivery. So if you're a CPAP user and you have Medicare, staying healthy with new CPAP equipment is easy. Just make this free phone call right now to get started.
Sponsored by Specialty Medical.
800-846-2153. 800-846-2153. 800-846-2153. That's 800-846-2153.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's Vine to Bar Chocolate. Order some today at vinetobar.com. That's VINETOBAR.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
Do you remember Herbert W. Armstrong? Do you remember his magazine, The Plain Truth? His television program, The World Tomorrow? The one and only possible message of world peace?
Now we're living in the most serious and most momentous times of the history of this world.
Those who heard Herbert W. Armstrong speak remember the depth of thought, the clarity of expression, and the power of his message. He spoke for God. God warned this world through Herbert W. Armstrong, and he gave hope to this dying world through Herbert Armstrong. What happened to that ministry? What happened to that message? We discuss this and so much more on our program, The Trumpet Daily. We're live weekday mornings at 11 a.m. Central Time in the United States. You can listen at CRN Digital Radio, Channel 3, or watch the live video stream at our website, thetrumpet.com.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. Once again, thank you so much for joining us. The case we're speaking about right now is Students for Fair Admissions versus President and Fellows of Harvard College and joined with also the University of North Carolina. In the lawsuit, the plaintiffs claim that Harvard imposes soft racial quotas, which violate federal law, and keep the number of Asian Americans artificially low. The percentage of Asians admitted to Harvard, plaintiffs maintained, was suspiciously similar year after year, despite dramatic increases in the number of Asian American applicants and the size of the Asian American population. Harvard's response is that it denies engaging in discrimination and said that admissions philosophy on considering race is one of many factors in its admissions policy complies with the law. The school also says it receives more than 40,000 applications and that a large majority of applications are academically qualified, and as a result, it must consider more than grades and test scores to determine admission for 2,000 available slots. Richard, legalese aside, this is kind of seems a little bit unfair. I mean, shouldn't this be merit-based rather than all the quote-unquote other factors in consideration here?
Well, it's, you know, schools and universities, especially, we're talking about adults now. This is academics. What does the word academics mean? It's basically talking about those people who are versed in reading and writing and understanding the languages and so on. We should honor and welcome those people who rank the highest in our society that can use those tools. They may not be basketball players or football players, but they can use their heads very, very well. We should honor that asset, and if it turns out that more Asians, if you will, exceed in whatever Harvard tests are, then so be it. And I'm neither Asian nor whatever. My point is, my parents or grandparents were from Western Europe, and if it turns out that we Western European people have to take a second seat to the Asians in this case, I'm all for it.
As the plaintiffs allege that Asian American applicants have the lowest chance of admission of all other racial groups in the United States, despite scoring highest in all objective measurements.
Yes.
So, I mean, the proof is in the pudding there, folks. And also, we talked in our prep session too, Richard, that, you know, a merit-based college admissions process is great. I think we're all... shouldn't we also have a merit-based immigration system as well?
Absolutely. And the other thing, too, is, you know, many of these people, these Asians that do very well, English is their second language. That's the best part, that we Americans here, so to speak, that we're born here, that English is our first and only language, can't compete, and that's a shame.
And of course, you know, Harvard and many other, you know, top-ranked universities and universities in general, you know, they a lot of international students go there.
Absolutely.
So wouldn't it be wise if we have students, you know, high-performing academic achievers from mainland China come to Harvard? Wouldn't that be great? Because now we've exposed these kids from mainland China to American-style democracy,
right?
And they can return back to China and bring those democratic values back to their home country.
Well, yeah, and the only problem with that is they usually end up bringing back atomic secrets, too, when they go. So, you know, it works both ways, I guess.
There was a, you know, we're running out of time, but there's a great anecdote I heard about. There was a big controversy, and still a great controversy, about allowing military recruiters on college campuses.
Yes.
And I heard a great veteran, he wrote a great book called Matterhorn. I forget the gentleman's name. But he says, no, that doesn't, that's the, a lot of, you know, hippies said that it was going to turn the campus conservative.
Yes.
And he's like, no, it's going to liberalize the military.
Right.
And because you need diversity, you know, of thought in, I think, all important institutions. We'll probably we'll circle back to this case next week. Richard, we're out of time. Thank you very much.
You're so welcome.
Thank you out there to all those listening as well. Make sure to check out Richard's fantastic book, America, an Illusion of Freedom. Makes a great read. You can find it on Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. As always, all previous sessions are available on YouTube and as a podcast, crntalk.com/podcaster. Shoot Richard an email, PRES37, that's PRES37TH @AOL.com. Stick around. See you guys next week in the Legal Lounge.